find it ironic that the world is rough to us. Sharp around the edges, even though it's round. And your mind is faltering, circling the pain and doubt. I'll be a silver lining through your darkest cloud. I know, my dear, the path is sometimes treacherous, and you see no hope in this. Like all of the weight of the world's on your shoulders, and every step is poison, but you should know. If you hold my hand, you'll never be alone.
What's going on, everyone, and welcome to week two of the Hyperion Invitational Cup 2. It's week two for the second cup, and we're about to get things kicking off with our best of five or first to three tonight. I'm Los, joined by Vincent. And Vincent, we got a good game for us, don't we?
That we do. An early grudge match is the way our producer put it, or at least attempted, maybe said, could be. Either way, I'm excited to get things started, Los. This is going to be a good time.
Oh, yeah. Of course, of course. And what better way to check them out? We're going to look at our first team of the match. It's Frost Surge. Now, these are looking pretty solid because they won the first Hyperion Invitational Cup. They're back for blood, looking to hit that back for back. But this is going to be pretty nice. 1-0. Their opponents, on the other hand, it's going to be 0-7 Aquila. They're also 1-0. So it's undefeated. No one's ever lost here.
No.
There's only been one match.
No, never lost ever.
This is an undefeated series, so it's crazy. History will be made here at Hyperion. It's wild. It's mad.
I need a bajillion 07s in the chat, by the way. If there's no 07s, I am sad. Chat, you've not done your job. But I'm excited. Yeah, this is a good time. And, well, I think this is going to be pretty fun to watch and kind of see how things go down. Because, like you said, both teams 1-0 starting out very strong. And speaking of starting out, why don't we actually take a look at the overall standings and see where exactly that stands. And like we said, absolutely. Number one, number two, these two squads. So it's going to be a fight for who's going to be taking that top slot, at least for the moment.
Well, you know what? I have to take back what I said. It wasn't completely undefeated. You can see 07 Aquila.
What?
Only that plus two. Only that plus. I'm a liar.
You lied to me.
I'm wrong. Wait, is it worse to be a liar or is it worse to be wrong, Vincent? I'm not sure.
I'm going to choose to plead the fifth because there's no right answer there. None.
Yeah, because you agreed with me. You're in this as well. So.
I did. Well, you have to drag me down with you. That's just not very nice. But yeah, one map differential. That is the difference here. So does that technically make Aquila the underdogs coming into this one? Technically on paper, I guess.
I think so. Would it really be an underdog? I mean, there is an interesting story because some of the Aquila players, you know, formerly along with Frost Surge. So these are former members of their opponents. So maybe it does include that grudge match. You know, you have some people okay. you used to play with, or maybe it could be a little more fun. It's like hanging out with old friends. Now, I've never been a competitor, so I don't know what the emotions are when it's stirred up. But I feel like if you and me went on opposing broadcasts, there would be feelings some type of way, I would feel. So
I would feel.
Maybe we can imagine that there could be some mixed feelings. But regardless, 07 Aquila looking to outdo their old former team.
Yeah, you know, some crossover. I mean, you get that here in Overwatch as well. So everybody knows everybody. I feel like at this point we're so deep into the lore. But speaking of starting, we're going to be starting out over on Busan. That's going to be our first map of the evening, and I'm excited to see that one. So particularly because I'll be honest with you, I think Busan is like one of the best control maps. Like I love it.
Oh, yeah. No, it's a lot of fun just because we needed something fresh, right? And Busan was such a fresh addition in the control map pool. And I was happy to have it because you could also get some great plays from the top rope when you're in downtown, when you're in that city area. And just being up above is great if you're Ashe, if you're Hanzo, but also if you're the monkey. I love disrupting and ruining the party by jumping on there with Winston. It feels fun. And getting that high altitude is just crazy.
I can say for certain that you do enjoy ruining the party on Winston. No, I'm sorry. You didn't deserve that slander. That was made up entirely. I did not do my research. But I agree with you. It's a good time. We are looking to get started as well. I think we got all the R's in chat. And Busan going to be getting underway here shortly as we get forward. Here we go. And we're going to be starting out over here at the drum, as I like to call it. Big bongo there in the middle, but what are we expecting here, Los? What are you thinking?
Well, it's gonna be scrappy as all heck, right? I'm waiting to see what we're going to have on those initial hero picks, but I know that we're going to have Stormgig on the monkey. They love to run the Winston, which is something I will always respect. And there it is. We actually got some information. Frost Surge let us know what they like to run in terms of heroes. We're not listening to them. Nope.
They like to keep us on our toes, Los. That's what it's all about. But yeah, we are going to be seeing a little bit of a differentiation here. Obviously, things could change, but with the doors about to open, I'm thinking this is probably pretty much what we're going to be seeing. Pretty standard in the divey composition side on one, but it's going to be a ball versus the Winston. And of course, that ball is very powerful here on this map, particularly.
Oh yeah, the spin to win factor. There's multiple places you could just trap that hook onto and become a real nuisance for your opponents. But Nodlin, they're kind of waiting for the around the world, and what a rotation we're seeing coming from Frost Surge. They have gone all the way around. It's been a flip of the script, a flip of the sides completely, but now it feels that Frost Surge might be trapped.
Well, the point open for business. Whoever's going to get on there to get that first cap in Swarmgig. There we go. That's the way to start it out.
Okay, well, it looks like the trappers have become the trappies. This was so easy for Frost Surge to turn the tables. In fact, it was more of like an over-rotation where 07 Aquila essentially split themselves off.
Certainly felt that way. I mean, the whole goal of the composition, the running, is to disrupt with Nodlin and then utilize the additional damage from the Discord Orb to pick out one or two of these opponents, but that just never happened.
Here comes the Coalescence. We've got it right from Ziggity Zoot, a fantastic name and a fantastic use of the ultimate, but Stormgig following it up. It was a great EMP from Happy Circle, and now the majority of 07 Aquila is gone with the win.
That the R and Schism investing the Pulse Bomb a little late into that fight, not going to get value out of it. The good news, of course, is that this Reaper has farmed up on the ultimate, prepared to potentially make this an easy fight win. It's really going to be about trying to do the damage whilst not having Rocco in his way. We'll have to keep an eye on that one as the pressure is going to be applied on towards the back line with this ball touching on the point.
Oh, major or minor disruption from Nodlin. Sure, you pulled away Rook, but all the while, all of your team was getting destroyed, so you had to reset for nothing.
Well, I mean, not for nothing. I mean, Happy Circle just demolished the whole backline. Listen, Los, that is something. Let's give some credit where it's due. But nonetheless, it's certainly not ideal, and it's now really last chance to get back in here.
Before a hack, I don't think Happy Circle was able to pull it off, but even so, it crazed a distraction for this Death Plus to pull off. How long is by so they won't have the resurrection? Mako Neko, she utilized that self-destruction, and now it's a big opportunity for them to move on through the objective. That's three gone for Frost.
That it is. This should be an eventual win. Nova doing some nice shooting there with the Ash on the backside of this, but with 96% and Happy Circle approaching another EMP, this seems like it might be a bit of a difficult one to actually hold on to for 07 Aquila. They're in a tough spot, but I think the key will be for Schism to pick someone out. They need to get a pick here.
Looking for it with that pulse bomb, but you've been forced into a rough situation, and there's three immediately destroyed. 07 Aquila has no chance to strike back, and a quick conversion followed up with a quick finish for the first round.
Ziggity Zoop playing the DPS Moira. I understand. I've been there. That's just ridiculous. Getting away with a couple of kills, and it's going to be the attempt to touch, but has to be forced over the top as Rocko Neko, and unfortunately that means the objective has been secured with Frost Surge taking the first of the stage here on Busan.
Yeah, we're seeing that they have a strong control of, no pun intended, strong control of the map. And the one fault that they had was getting a bit too aggressive. They didn't exactly have the perfect setup. It was going into the back line. They weren't able to find that hack with Happy Circle, and a self-destruction kind of turned things in 07 Aquila's favor, not to mention a transcendence. If a hack was put in place properly, then it would have been another win for Frost Surge. But regardless, we can see what 07 Aquila is going to do to try and bounce back.
Well, it looks like they're running the same composition, R07 Aquila. They are, I mean, it's the same idea, right? Use this Discord orb that I think they struggled a little bit to use in that last stage, and they need to use it effectively. On the other side, though, Frost Surge has gone for a more brawly of composition. They're going to start things out there with the punch in from the Doomfist, but gets burned down and out.
Yeah, Happy Circle, no chance, was dead before they even landed. Essentially, it only took time to find the facts, but it will be Frost Surge sitting on the objective. They may be able to claim it. Yeah, there's no chance for Nova to jump down. They'll just be poked away from the top rope. Then some shots in and removing the immortality field. So wait a minute. This is a good opportunity. But Frost Surge, they're jumping up to the top looking for the kills, but they won't find it until now. Three gone, making about four in just a moment.
Stormgig getting aggressive there. The Lucio really enabling this Reinhardt very effectively. And despite the fact that Nova had the chance to basically free shoot over the entirety of that fight because of Happy Circle going down early and nobody being able to deny that area from Nova, it still goes the way of Frost Surge because of the fact that Stormgig was just uncontested.
And now it's just a consistent Frost Surge hold of the high ground, and they're looking around, picking apart their opponents, and this TP was a great rotational tool. Now they can hit him with the pinch, but Schism there to keep them in check. Now in the bottom ground, they had that immortality field. No one is targeting it. It's a free fire and a free safety net for Frost Surge. All this time, they've been sending out damage, but this is the time they can finally finish it off.
Minefield on the point. That should buy some space and time. But nobody's actually going to be able to capture that just yet with four players still alive.
So this is a not exactly a good hold. It's a good contest, but the percentage is still going up for Frost Surge. Finally, we have three gone for Frost Surge. It is a conversion of the point.
That it is. And you know what? I think that despite the timeline there being a little bit whack, it's still a really solid capture from Aquila. The reason I say that is because they've set themselves up with a large number of ultimates. All they had to do was invest the minefield, and then a little later on, they used the Valkyrie. But it's not a problem. As long as they can get back in here, they'll be okay. But this is so good to be able to close the distance. This TP is perfect.
Oh my god, surprise, we're here to party, and the Death Blossom is the cherry on top. That's already a dismantling, a destruction of 07 Aquila. 07's in the chat, pay respects to this team for their attempted defense.
They had no chance to actually answer there, actually try to use the ultimates. It would have been ideal if they could have pulled out the Transcendence, but okay, a little late, but well, just to confirm, it's going to be the Graviton Surge. And the good news is Stormgeek still has the Earth Shatter in his back pocket to utilize coming forward. So last fight territory now. 07 Aquila gonna have to use all of the tricks in their kit to bring this one back. And they've already forced the immortality.
Tank ultimates. Now you gotta bring out the minefield. If Nodlin can get in a good position to set this up, then we'll set themselves right. Transcendence caught by Greffin. However, out of position away from their teammates, they can't provide the help. But that was just a necessary move to get on the point, to stall it out, because it's overtime. But this time it's over for 07 Aquila. But Nova is making a strong case for themselves. They won't go down quietly, they'll actually convert it back.
Oh, Nova has just been free shooting! Oh my goodness! And it's a great decision there by Rook to just... So, okay. Ziggity Zoot thought they had a way back out. Not gonna happen. But as I was saying, Nova needs to be punished there. There's just no world in which he should be getting away with it. And you can see Rook has swapped over to this D.Va. I would argue solely to deal with the fact that Nova's Ash is so dang strong. We are also seeing Skaro attempt to put the pressure on from long range.
That was a crazy attempt. Another use of that teleportation, and right in that moment, Schism was hoping to use that pulse bomb. It was eaten, and they're eaten up. Their opponents, a conversion of the point, and no one can jump onto the objective. It'll be a last attempt by Rook. However, the second they do, D-Meg and destroyed. This is just a quick cleanup or a slow and extended one. Frost Surge are going to win this out.
Yeah, I don't see how they couldn't. Skaro doing some heavy lifting on the Cassidy there on the backside of this one. All of the olds and the Deadeye at the end of the day. It's down to Frost Surge for map number one of this first to three series in Los. I gotta love what I was seeing there. The intelligence that we were seeing from Frost Surge on their composition choices and them being so aware of their weaknesses was amazing. But look at this. I would argue the only reason that this was so close is because of Nova doing things like this.
Yeah. You know, talking about those weaknesses, that's a clear showcase of what exactly we're talking about. Giving Nova the space to make those shots, allowing them to have free and clear access to deal so much damage. You take that away and you put more pressure, which is what we saw with the utilization of those sim teleports, getting right into the face of 07 Aquila. That made it so much more difficult for them to contest and contain that high ground, to have their defenses set up. And once that was taken away, it was scrambling for the 07 squad.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, and the other thing to kind of think about there, right? Like the swaps that they made in order to deal with Nova were just so smart from Frost Surge. They knew what to do and they did it very quickly. They swapped over to the Cassidy to apply some long range damage and at least make Nova feel a little bit uncomfortable. And a lot of the damage that Nova was doing, sure, it was the shots being fired, but it was also those dynamites. They were long burns. Swap over onto the D.Va, and suddenly that is not so big a deal. So lots to love, but 07 Aquila, they were there or thereabouts. It was just a couple of general mistakes. That would be the better term that allowed Frost Surge to be just a little bit above them.
Yeah, no, I'm enjoying the fact that they had a major increase in their performance into the mecha base, because it felt very disjointed, the team play. on that first round because Nodalin wouldn't make a move, try and separate, do a little bisection of their opponents, but it never felt that it came to fruition. It felt that they were activating themselves all at the wrong times, but there was a lot more cohesion that we saw from them going into that second round. So I'm hoping that it grows. I'm hoping that we see a bit more strength because the signs are there. Their adaptability that we saw from Frost Surge was just a lot to handle. But it's still a long series. It's only the first map, and I would not be surprised if O7 Aquila can bring this back and make it a competitive series.
I wouldn't be surprised either. Part of the reason that I would not be so surprised is that they get to pick the map. This is loser pick, which means a loss in that first map does set O7 Aquila up for a potential success, and it looks like they've elected to send us to Blizzard World. I'm excited to see this one, mostly because I think that it's so very different than what we were actually seeing previously. Like if we'd gotten to downtown on Busan, then like compositionally it would be pretty similar, and it may be very divey, especially on that second point. But I think we could see some, you know, basically anything on that first point.
Mm-hmm. And now I'm going to look back to Nova again with some great poke potential because there are sight lines in this map. If they bring it back onto the Ash, it's just going to be a big, big issue. You will need some dives. You will need to bring that Cassidy back in. So I'm going to have to reprise that role of the Winston just to create some dives. I mean, Rook as well, using that D.Va would be a good pick. So it's all about how you can react, how you can counteract that damage. But when it's that long sight line, because it isn't control, it isn't a confined space, you have to find a better way to close that distance.
That's a great point that you made there. Unfortunately, I have bad news for you, Los.
Oh, no.
Unfortunately, Nova has been taken out and Stealth has come in. Now, I mean, I'll be honest with you. I saw that from Nova last map, and I agree, but obviously, O7 Aquila knows something that we don't know, and so we'll have to see what Stealth can do, whether or not they can bring it in. To be fair, I do see a top 500 player profile, so
you know that's.
I'm not gonna say when that happened because of course it could have happened anytime, and it could be in 1v1s or 3v3s, but you know.
Yeah. No one will take away.
You got there project, somewhere. Right? You know, that's what I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
You can't diminish that skill. You know, I know that I'm an absolute professional in total madness in the arcade. You won't stop me.
That's right. You beat me. You don't want to meet me in competitive deathmatch.
In the lobbies, I'm a menace.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. You never know. We'll leave that to be determined. But what we will know for sure is that we're going to be getting started here on Blizzard World. It's going to be the defense by the look of it for the Frost Surge side of things. At least it looks like it. And so 07 Aquila, of course, they pick them out. They don't get the chance to decide where they would like to start. And this is why I was saying we could see something very different. It's double shield, everyone's favorite composition. That sounded like there was pain in that laugh.
Yes. I forgot what patch we were playing on. The entirely wrong game.
you were looking for some Junker Queen? Yeah, sorry.
Oh yeah, no, listen, I would honestly say that's worse.
Okay. Strong opinions aside, I don't know if that's a hot take or not, I'll be honest. I do know what is looking hot. It's the gameplay we've got ready to go. It's a dive comp and a pretty darn standard one at that, coming out from 07 Aquila. They're going to be going with the same tank line, and Schism back reprising the role once again as the Tracer, but Stealth has gone for the Genji.
I'm liking it. That's what I'm talking about, closing that gap. You have that diving capability, but I mean, let's say you get behind those shields. What's your move then? A little shield bash coming out from Omni would do the trick. We can see two already gone for 07. They might have to reset from the jump.
They might. I love this angle. This is the most disgusting angle on Hanzo, to be honest. And it is, I'm here for it. That's all I'm saying. Happy Circle making me love what I'm seeing. But this double shield is working out strong. The pressure being applied by this dive composition is very spread out. And, well, Stormkick might be a bit in trouble now. Is on an island of sorts. It's just a question of when will 07 Aquila actually take advantage of it.
Okay, Nodlin could be dealt with, but they do have backup with stealth. But unfortunately, without a follow-up from the rest of their team, they can't make a move. Now that there's been more pressure applied, they can jump in. Stealth, sending out some of those shurikens, but Rook already de-met. It's a little too late for the follow-up. They just gotta fall back.
Indeed, there's nothing that can be gained here, especially with the Genji going down. Try to staunch this bleeding. And how long is Mai going down as well? There is just massive ultimate farming potential going on right now. You can see Stormkick is already in a gravitic flux. It's going to be the Dragon Strike and Deadeye as well. This is Frost Surge just standing tall and looking very good at the moment. And the bad news here, Los, I mean, yeah, Kraven has this nano boost, but there's no blade to go with it.
No. Yeah, they still have quite a ways to go. They could try farm, but I mean, there isn't much time. Sure, a minute 45 seems like a lot, but if they can't even get a single tick, they're looking at some bad news. However, following up with the Dragon Strike, Schism's already gone. Happy Circle's getting aggressive. You have Stormkick sending out some shots as well, and they don't even need to leave their position.
I mean, talk about good value. That is great value. Because getting away with a fight victory with only utilizing the dragons there, I mean, come on. I feel like the dragons, that's like a throwaway ultimate at times. And to win an entire fight off the back of it is simply too good. It's finally time, though, for this big ultimate battle to come through. 60 seconds on the clock, and everyone essentially needs to be pressing Q for 07 Aquila. The first is going to be the gravitic flux, though.
Starting it up, I'm not sure who was caught. It was actually Kraven! Kraven's gone! No nano to speak of, and Nodlin unavailable to provide peel for their team. Stealth does bring out that Dragon Blade. This could be a huge moment, and it is. Press Q, and it's all you gotta do. This should be the point for 07 Aquila.
It will be, and I mean, listen, I hate to be that guy, but Stealth didn't even get big value out of the blade. It was more a distraction than anything. Everybody else is the one that got the value out. Forcing a immortality, that might be a problem. With both of the supports, I should say, coming back pretty quickly, though. Okay, no. I was gonna say, this might be good to stall out, but instead, it's actually a problem. With Omni going down, and it looks like more to follow.
Rook shall fall as well, so this is an unfortunate situation. They'll just put their lives for the good of the ultimate economy for their opponents. Not what you want. Okay, strong commitment of that self-destruction. Rako Neko, she probably could have utilized that in a better sense. But all this while, they're pushing the cart.
That they are, and that's what is the objective, so fair enough. Full investment from pretty much both sides. The only one who didn't really invest there is Nodlin and Kraven, but nonetheless, oh, that's a great start. Rook taking out how long is my, and this is going to mean the beginning of the end for this fight.
Another one of those situations where it feels very disjointed from 07. They spread themselves too thin in that commitment going deep to cause that long-term delay, but now it's like a pendulum. They're feeling the same effect.
And a bit of a miss there by Schism. Isn't able to find anyone on the pulse bomb. But on Happy Circle's side, it's too easy. Quickly finding how long is my. And once again, they're the first down and out. This time, it wasn't a positioning error. It was just getting hit with that ultimate. Oh, man. Too bad.
Maybe not the window, but I don't even know where it is. What? It's all the way to the spawn. Ziggity Zoot just says, 1v1 me. I don't care. And that actually works. It cuts off the support from the spawn. So now it isolates the rest of 07 who are committing to this fight.
Frost Surge is playing on a different level at the moment. That commitment from Ziggity Zoot, it just explains how much they are feeling confident in Skaro. On the Cassidy, this is matched with Schism easily. There's no entry available with one man down. It's a swap over to the Cassidy for Schism as well. Finally, the Nano Blade is coming.
This is what we've been waiting for. And here it comes. Stealth with the Nano Blade, but gets stunned instantaneously. Still is able to pull off a kill onto Scarrow and follow it up with a second Omni. No longer able to help. And with this Transcendence, it is all good feelings for 07 Akela. Calm as can be. So we'll move around this pillar.
Bit ambitious there from Happy Circle. I'll keep it real with you, Los. The attempt to throw in the little spawn. No way he gets away with it. No way! No! Schism! You can't let him do you like that! It's still not a good decision. Happy Circle's gonna get punished for the re-engagement now. 5v5.
Absolutely styled on, but what is it worth? Scarrow up top having 3 shots away. There's the self-destruction. Creates such a hole. Everyone away from the ejected. 2 down. Followed up with a D-Mech and a stun to create even more serenity for the Frost Surge squad as it is clear as day.
I'm going to be honest. I gave Happy Circle a hard time for that one. And in reality, that was ridiculous. Should have just gone for the reset. But it ultimately did work out. And the reason it did is because everyone started to focus on Happy Circle. And it allowed the rest of the team to come forward. And despite the fact that the DPS traded one for one in the 5v5, 07 Akela weren't ready. They weren't prepared. They weren't watching. And it allows Rook to just get the double kill there with the self-destruct. Los, this is some exciting Overwatch.
Oh, absolutely fantastic. Now I'm curious as to the follow-up. How does Frost Surge top that? How do they look even better? You know what? They don't need to. They just need to stay consistent with their play. It was a good push from 07 Akela after a long struggle just to get that first objective, but once they did, they were able to get rolling. But after that moment, that was like the greatest piece of their cohesive attack. It's almost flashbacks back to Busan, where they weren't working together.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit tough because I think that not working together is not really what's happening. It's just that they're getting caught out in a little bit of an aggressive moment, right? The intention isn't there, but it really is, at the end of the day, the story. It's been that the cohesiveness of Frost Surge is simply one cut above what we're seeing from 07 Akela. One map down and a significant portion of this map done as well. Frost Surge have set the win condition, at least for this second map.
Taking a lot of damage. Stealth utilizing the Pharah. I'm liking it. I dig it, especially when you have that big damage boost coming in from How Long Is My. Question is, how long will this benefit last? I mean, almost over halfway to the Rocket Barrage, so this could be critical for the upcoming fight and extending their desire to cause that damage. With Stormgig's aggression, it hasn't paid off.
Very aggressive. Schism trying to play distraction on towards Scarrow. That Cassidy, if you're stuck dealing with a Tracer, then you aren't shooting up at the Pharah Mercy. Of course, Pharah gonna be returned with the Mercy because that Ana fell down. The resurrection there pretty quickly, about 3 minutes now on the clock, and still no real opening pick with the exception of that Ana, and that I think is a bit of a problem. Stealth applying so much damage is going to have the ultimate too quickly.
Okay, now that has just been a bit of a scramble, but it's not enough, especially when you already commit that bubble. However, the nice jump gives Stormgig an escape, and it doesn't get the kill onto Happy Circle. Circle's gone, but so is How Long Is My. Stealth won't last for so long without that heal, especially in the sky. Once the eyes look up, that's when your time is up and 3 are dead. It seems that Frost Surge are looking to take the first objective.
That they are. The nicely placed, by the way, the defense matrix from D.Va. That was Rook on towards Omni. Kept Omni alive. Stealth was basically going fully all in on the attempt to go trade out on the Brigitte of Omni. But the defense matrix saves Omni's life, and I think that is ultimately what allows them to stay healthy in this fight for as long as they did. It's now time to rethink, I believe, on this Pharah, because stealth in this second point, it's a lot more difficult to stay safe in the skies.
Rocko Neko, she's just sitting on top of that anti-aircraft. But it's great. earned herself that self-destruction. Can send it through. Will it be an ultimate commit? They already dropped the minefield. Nodlin stunned now, taking a serious amount of damage. Denied from the health pack. And that is just a major series of unfortunate events here for 07 Aquila. Deadeye ready for the Eyes of the Sky. It could be pulled off, but I don't think the commitment is coming. Okay, well, there it is. There it is. I was wrong.
Wait, who? What got eaten there? It must have been a pulse bomb. Happy Circles, I think, got eaten by Rocco Neko, so nicely done. Somehow this fight's still continuing with Schism alive, but only for a moment. And I want to go back to Nodlin on that ball. I know this fight is still a little bit crazy. He got hit with the main tank feeling. Just double stunned.
Tough. But let's talk about the toughness of this squad. They aren't giving it up yet. Stormgig holding it down on the objective, on the payload. But anyone who tries to stop this is facing massive opposition. Here's the anti. It forces Nodlin away, and now Rocco Neko, she's all alone. She can't provide that safety, that security, as the baby D.Va with this jump back into action from the final tank. There is no help in these final moments, and Frost Surge win map 2.
Not only just map 2, but that puts them up 2-0 in this series. Nicely done. Stealth. Somehow going to get play of the game here. I'm not... Okay. This was the Nano Blade, so... Fair enough.
Yeah, not bad.
It's too bad The end of this fight was basically them getting distracted by Happy Circle for... like 15 minutes and ultimately losing. It's so tragic because like I just realized that was the beginning of the fight and the end of the fight was just getting re-engaged upon because they couldn't kill Happy Circle. But I think that one moment where Nodlin just gets the full main tank experience just sort of encapsulates that map for 07 Aquila. Just getting hit with the flashbang, then McWright clicked, and then and then ultimately gets shield bashed and McWright clicked again. Like, that just sucks.
That's what we call a feels bad, man. But there's time to cool down in between these maps because we're going to throw it to a quick little break. Before we go, I just want to say this is going to be an incredible map 3, so don't go anywhere. The Hyperion Invitational Cup 2 right back after this.
Thank you.
you know, we are headed to a different map. It is Havana, which we were talking about the long-range engagements, and we're talking about Nova as well. He happens to be coming back in, by the way, so the savior we needed.
Woo. Welcome back. Welcome back, Nova. Your team has been needing you for those long range. I mean, to say need you, you didn't win the map that Nova was on. So that's not exactly the saving grace.
But you didn't have to do him dirty. Come on. Yeah,
hey, you know, it wasn't me. Look at the scores right here, Vincent. True. I didn't make that happen.
It was not you. That was all Frost Surge all the time. And U7 Aquila, they were not able to make the adjustments. And honestly, I don't even think adjustments was the problem or even lack thereof. I just think that it was clear that Frost Surge are making decisions a little bit quicker, right? Like, they are engaging, disengaging, and fighting for space in a much timelier manner.
Yeah, no, it's quick reactions and quick thinking. If we're going to go back to that moment where it was, I believe, Scarab just mixing the two other DPS in the side room, because taking that opportunity, it was a quick communication. Yeah, just rinsed them.
Yeah, they did. It's true. I mean, took them to town, you know, showed them around, you know, all of the phraseology that we like to use here on the desk, Liz. Everything, all of it, all at once. It was not good, to say the least. But now it could be different. We could be seeing things change. Schism did play pretty well, in my opinion, though not going to be in this time. It's our top 500 stealth joining Nova with Schism out this time. So I think it's going to be a good time.
Yeah, and I didn't even get to make my point because it was just too fun using those terms. But no, it wasn't even that play in the side room that mattered. It was the quick thinking, the quick communication for the rest of the team to get aggressive as they could be in that moment where the two DPS were distracted, were upheld in the side room. That quick thinking, that adaptability, and that realization there's some weak spots in their opponent's attack or defense is what's going to set Frost Surge apart from their opponent.
Well, that's certainly what has been setting them apart. We'll see if that can continue on Havana, as we've been discussing. It's going to be the time for our selection of the heroes here, and it's back to some double shield for the first point, I would imagine, and the second, more than likely, should it get there. And it's going to be double sniper as well, so a pretty classical composition on this map for Frost Surge. On the other side of things, it's sort of the same, but also different, if you know what I'm saying. We're getting a ball along with the Sigma, which is something that we have seen pretty often, but have yet to see from this squad. Correct me if I'm wrong, Los. Is that... Well, never mind. Don't worry about it. I got you baited.
Yeah, I don't know. There's always adaptability in the squad, and I understand that as a Sigma male myself, the grind never stops. So you gotta keep changing. You gotta keep thinking of new things. But Scarab, looking for that initial shot. Wow, I'm loving that with the halt to bring up Noodling, break the shield, look for a cheeky headshot. Not giving, but the idea behind it, I'm liking. We're getting a creep up from 07, though.
Even if they don't actually get this kill, it's forcing the shield break, all of these sorts of things, and putting the team in a tough spot. So, nonetheless, this double shield going to have to be falling back. Great pathing from the offense of 07 Aquila. They're doing all of the right things to set themselves up for success here. But the D.Va even forcing out Scarab and Nova with a nice shot on the Cassidy.
Great follow-up now, dropping down Nova, completely uncontested. Not a single shot landing in that Cowboy's direction, and it is pressure into this corner. However, how long is Mai losing their life? They have to back off because Griffin isn't going to be able to keep everyone safe in this scenario. Ziggity Zoot even getting their name on the board, and this is a tough scenario. You're trapped.
trapped but absolutely jacked is this Reaper trying to fight their way out. Unfortunately, Stormgig is showing off the true Sigma grind set and making sure that this was not a problem. 97% nearing that Gravitic Flux as well. The only thing actually available is, once again, Prevent is worked their way up to the window, made some good moves. That could do some damage to this double shield.
Okay, in the bar, looking to break on out and raise the bar. How long is mine? Takes the first shot, Scarrow goes down, but the rest of 07 goes up. The tank line cracked up, but they're kept alive using this immortality field. Finally, it will be broken. Even though the Dragon Strike was used in that moment, it still beefed them up. They're beaten, broken, bashed. So we'll have Frost Surge take things back.
Maybe battered, but not out of this one just yet. Frost Surge still very much alive and kicking. They pushed the entirety of 07 Aquila into this little corner. And the thing about it is that the range that is available to Frost Surge is just significantly better than what 07 Aquila have to offer. And so that's why they've been forced up into these small areas. And it is going to be the re-engagement. Surely this Earth Shatter is going to come in.
It has to be Nodlin looking for that off angle. If this is a possibility from the top of the staircase, it could be huge, but the shields are blocking it. There's no chance. The barrier almost destroyed, but they have the sound barrier instead. And following up, it's a triple with the Earth Shatter. However, Nodlin and crew, they're feeling the heat, and they've been destroyed even though the set was seen for them. It's all ruined now. They have to back up.
Oh, this window, though, might be able to bring this back, turn the tide. But a great disengagement overall, playing around the cart and forcing them to push forward, not getting max value out of it.
Brook, lighten it up, follow it up with a Deadeye from Scarrow. Oh, the 1v1, no! Oh, Stormgig coming in for a little bit of help. A tactical crouch just to ensure that nobody shoots you in the head. 19 seconds left for 07 Aquila to bring it to the first objective.
That supercharger really makes it difficult to push forward, we'll just say. The other thing is that halt was so perfect from Rook to get him into this spot, but here we go. Last fight, last try.
Barrier broken, oh my God. And there go the two tanks. And with a matter of seconds, Rocco Neko, she saves it.
So they've disengaged and it isn't going to be any sort of re-engagement onto the point. So confirmation, 2.5 more minutes to work with as everyone pushes forward. And the good news, of course, for 07 Aquila is that they have kept on to this in a whole gappy circle.
Great kill with that Dragon Strike, and now at the top of those distillery bottles, containers, whatever it is, the high ground. We've got it. Nice.
They probably are just distilleries. That's probably the right word. You probably had it. I ain't got a clue. I'm smooth brain. But you know who is it? Stealth, who has the ultimate ready to go on the Reaper. Get close. Find a way to close the distance with the Lucio, and this could be the tie turner.
Rocco Neko removing the high ground, followed up with that Ant Matrix. You gotta break all the barriers, and once you break those barriers, you can shatter them even further with the Death Blossom, and also Nodlin with the Earth Shatter itself. They have the opportunity. That's what they need to do, but with Krepin falling, it's gonna be difficult. We've seen Nodlin have a great shatter before, but is the follow-up working in for their favor? No! They still try to push it again. It doesn't work. They're rebuffed by Frost Surge for a second time.
I'm not sure who hit the stun, whether it was a flash or whether it was a shield bash, but one of them, Omni or Skaro, they just destroyed Stealth. That Earth Shatter was attempted to be followed up upon by the ultimate on the Reaper, but nothing came out. He got stunned out of it. That is so frustrating. And so without it, now it's time to push in, re-aggress with the Mei instead.
Coming up with that Gravitons for the Gravitic Flux. It doesn't matter now. Nothing was actually pulled, I don't think. However,
no.
It is going to be an ultimate that flies under the radar, but the presence of it and still have an impact. Yet we do have 07 Aquila breaking their way through. Talking about ultimates denied. Scarrow using one and done. Now we're gonna fall right after, but it will still be a struggle. There's 12 seconds left, and 07 Aquila isn't going down without a fight or going down without this second point.
Oh, but Storm Gig can come in here. Supercharger has gone out. It's Garo on the one side, the tank line on the other. Happy Circle down and out. Things are looking a little bit difficult.
Supercharger, and we have that Earth Shatter, but all of this, the barrier's gone and destroyed. There's no chance for Frost Surge to end it here.
No, I mean, it was a valiant attempt from Frost Surge to get back into this one. Fair enough, but there wasn't the player numbers, right? Like, they had Rook and Storm Gig, and then it was Scarrow on the left-hand side, but no one else was there, and they just lost both of their supports, if I'm not mistaken, with Ziggity Zoot coming back a little bit quicker. So, ultimately, they lose out on a couple of those ultimates. Omni swapping over as well in order to apply some additional damage.
Oh, Nova. Right in the mouth of the beast, and they get chomped. A quick rebuttal here coming from Frost Surge, and I believe that's three dead, maybe about to be a fourth, but they have to go for a reset.
That they do, and oh, well, that reset's going to be a little longer than intended, with Scarrow, who moved over to the Ash, giving Nova a run for his money. 30 seconds. Especially considering that now, wait, Happy Circle onto a Widowmaker. Interesting. Oh. They've got to be caught out in the open. Not prepared was Nova. That Deadeye isn't even worth it to hang on to.
I mean, they may want to keep it. Here comes the window from Creeping.
He wants
to get it. If it helps, where's this even happening? Just to break on out, Scarrow does fall, and they look for a rotation around the objective. They surrounded them, and Rook falls as well. Things need to keep cool, and it will be a reset for Cross Surge.
That will. Great movement here. I love that they're just falling back, not trying to re-engage. That's why they took such an early engagement in order to buy the time. And the overtime wick burning means that all that needs to happen is the rest of 07 Aquila to be pushed off of this cart.
No chance. It's all one team wipe. It's all that remains. Nova going around for a cheeky angle. They've got the Deadeye. How long is Mod the first one to fall? Here comes Bob to play and join the party. One barrier is out, but I think everyone's been pushed off.
And that's the power of that overtime wick burning. It's just about knocking the opponents off of the cart for long enough to push it over the edge. A valiant push, though. That was very strong. The best we've seen from 07 Aquila, I would argue, all series long, Los. That is the difference. So, question is it enough?
I mean, it's the greatest push that they've had so far. It all depends on what is their defense going to be. Will that have a similar upgrade? And I'm hoping so, because I want to see more of 07 Aquila. I don't want it to end right here on Havana. I think there's more to tell in this story, but it all depends on what this initial fight is going to be.
That's fair. Yeah, I mean, if we see Frost Surge start rolling, then I think it gets a little bit scary. But pushing all the way that far, I mean, on Havana, that is certainly a very strong showing. Cannot deny. And we're seeing a pretty similar composition. In fact, the same composition being pulled out here for the defense of Aquila. They have elected to keep with the D.Va and the Reinhardt. And I am curious, though, if Happy Circle is going to keep on this Sombra. And the reason I say that is I think this could be very effective. We saw Happy Circle working the Sombra very well, but I think this is going to be a swap. And it will be. It's going to be the Pharah for this first point.
There is a response. It's Nova. That long-range engagement. And, oh, my God, Arako Neko. She says, you're not going to have any part in this, guys. I'll take you on any
Those
day.
Those are mine. I'll be having them.
It's comical, the slide down that Rocco Neko did, and that almost, for me, is going to define this fight. Nodlin wants to get aggressive, and it really is over. Nova's gone. Nodlin cut away from the rest of their team. Sure, they're shooting into the spawn, but it doesn't really matter. Scarrow's already on the objective. It's a wraparound.
Yeah, and the worst news here is normally the whole point of holding close there is that you stall out the cart for additional time. That didn't happen, so the fight was continuing. The cart was just rolling. It was zooming. There was no problems whatsoever, and Omni's going to bring Skaro back on the Cassidy from the grave. It's already two ultimates prepared. With Ziggity Zoot ready to put down the window, that Ant Matrix with such a massive amount of damage potential.
Now with the high ground, Nodlin fairly close up to that Earth Shatter if they get a couple of whacks in.
Well,
the barrier's gone, they have to go swinging. Nova taking the eyes of the sky, the bullets away from that bar. However, they're in an island. They have no support. 74 HP. Now with the focus shifted to them, it's all over. A few left alive in this fight, but they are soon to fall to the rest of their team.
Oh my goodness. The res comes away, and it's just rolling all the way to victory for Frost Surge. They're taking point number one, and it only really cost them that Ant Matrix. That's the scary part. If you are a fan of Usem Aquila, that's what you're terrified about, because now they can just overwhelm the Supercharger as well.
However, oh my god, the Rocket Barrage taking down both the supports. You've got no health now, and you've got no help to follow it up. This is a quick, easy victory in this first fight.
Return to spawn, that's what that is short for. Quick Rocket Barrage is going to take out both of the supports. And like you said, supports, well, without them, you're not going to be living very long. They do keep you healthy. Happy Circle is going to swap off of the far onto the Genji, which maybe is a little bit different than we would have expected, considering that we were seeing that Sombra early on. But nonetheless, we'll see how this goes. Nice placement, though, of the dragons, right?
They just destroyed that immortality field. It's going to be a nightmare for 07 Aquila, but it's not done. Nova only 9 HP. Somebody's got to finish them, and it is Happy Circle following it up in the back line. This is an anime enjoyer. That was their fun fact, and they're having a lot of fun right now. Happy Circle not even touched. There's a third, potentially making it a fourth. Nobody can stop them. Happy Circle is not done yet.
Now this is how you play the Genji. We hadn't seen too much of that classical Genji play yet, but just 1 minute in, and Happy Circle, he certainly is an anime enjoyer, taking out 92% to that blade, and it is time to fight for this second point. We're gonna have to move forward into the Supercharge Ant Matrix duo.
Allowing them to push past the distillery, make their way to the castle, follow it in stealth with the Death Blossom. A resurrection is put into play, yet stealth, they're not done. Ziggity Zoot will put them to rest, but it has to be a regroup and a reset coming here for Frost.
Yeah, and I mean, big props to Nova. He's the one who really stalled out that push. I got somehow in towards the back line and dispatched with the Supercharger, both of the tanks, and even more, and stealth was able, or not stealth, excuse me. Yeah, it was stealth on the Reaper, now on the Genji. Was able to follow up on that with the Death Blossom, but nonetheless, Skaro was swapped over and already found an opening pick, getting stunned up, but it doesn't seem to matter.
That was actually a pretty huge flashbang in terms of how many people it got, but the impact in the fight, well, not quite so huge. 5 dead there for 07 Aquila.
A little less than perfect. And you know what's crazy? Stealth swapped over to that Genji, I believe, in order to mirror Happy Circle. As soon as he swapped over, Happy Circle onto the Hanzo. Sorry, I'll be taking something different. And look at this aggression. They found Nodlin might be out of position as alongside Rocco Neko, and they're trying to deny it.
Okay, Nova. This is the snipes that we've been waiting for, and there is a great denial here from 07 Aquila.
And it's that crossfire Nova was able to help put together by swapping over to the Widowmaker. It's perfectly done at the right time, and oh, the shield goes down! Happy Circle's face comes off.
Now they will need to just walk up with these barriers, make it much more difficult for Nova to find those angles, but at this point, you gotta worry about closing the gap, playing those sight lines, and getting the truck up. Dragon Strike, but oh, the Earth Shatter coming through from Nautilin. We've seen this story before. Scarrow hits with that tactical visor, but they're trapped alone, and it's another failure push for Frost.
That it is. Nova once again shutting down, this time the tact visor, and it's going to force a swap for Scarrow. Lots of answering these swaps back and forth from DPS. A really intelligent back and forth it has been. And look at how aggressive Nautilin is being. They don't want to allow them to get out of spawn because they know they can apply the pressure with those long range DPS.
Oh, even Nautilin jumping in.
What?
Oh my lord!
No!
It's illegal! That can't be right! Rocco Neko destroys them with a self-destruction right outside of their spawn.
Oh man, just throwing the bomb down right there on the spawn door, confirming that nobody can get away. Nobody can find the space. And with only a minute 16 remaining, it's time to move.
See, there's a pinch around the corner. Everyone is collapsing on top of Frost Surge. It's a surge against them. They have no chance for escape, no hope whatsoever.
This is the first time I think that that Frost Surge has actually gotten a little bit flustered. This is what they need to do. They need to swap to a bit of a more brawly composition in order to close this distance, but it might be too little too late.
I think it is. Yeah, with an immortality field on their opponent's stealth with the Dragon Strike for two. This is bullying. This just seems hopeless. Frost Surge, helpless.
Yeah, these are the right swaps. They're finally doing all the right things, but it's taken them almost 2 minutes to figure out what the right things are. It's now onto ZigGityZoot to put this Ant Matrix in the right spot.
It starts off Nautilin gone, but the Immortality Field follows it up. However, both tanks are out of commission. This is their chance to move on through. The snipers are still a nuisance, but they won't be a destructive element.
Yeah, there we go. And it's exactly as I said, you had to swap to a more brawly composition in order to get it out of the spawn room. Of course, the problem is now you're on a brawly composition and a long range dual engagement with Stealth and Nova that you're really going to be in a tough spot with. Of course, with overtime ticking, it's really about this one fight and one fight only.
With that wick, they lose too much time on this one, on this overtime. It forces them to leave the site, but nobody dies.
Bailey for Dodge Field.
Nodlin's gone. How long is mine? Maybe soon to follow. A wall denying the block, denying the angle, and it gives Frost Surge the time to
push.
Move on through. A D-Mech and two more dead. There's no chance after 07 Aquila put in so much work to stop them from winning. Frost Surge, surge anyway, and find victory in three.
That they do, and it was all down to that brawl stall at the very last moment. I mean, 07 Aquila, they did everything right. They set themselves up for success. It was just about whether or not Frost Surge would actually figure out, okay, we need to just take the brawl mirror to get out of our spawn. They did figure it out. It took them a little while to do that, but once they did, it was just a roll, and they did all of the right things to deal with Nova and Stealth on those long range engagements. I mean, just really, really solid stuff.
Yeah, once they had more stability with those shields to keep themselves protected, and even a nice use of that ice wall from May to keep that sightline out of play, it was just a perfect finish and a great read. And they weren't exactly very quick with their ability to make that adjustment and that change, but they did it to perfection. And that's going to be it. Frost Surge have won it out, but we're not done here yet. We're going to come back after a quick break, so don't go anywhere. We'll be back after this. Hey, welcome back. We're here at the end of this beautiful series. It's Frost Surge up 3-0-7 Aquila, unable to bring it back in the very end. But from Frost Surge, we've got Scarrow. And Scarrow, I gotta ask you, you mentioned it earlier in the pre-show call. You wanna drop a bar. Now you destroyed 0-7 Aquila. Nightmares, their dreams are feeling harrowed. So how about a bar from my main man, Scarrow?
Oh, what the? On the spot? All right. Ready? Let's see.
Let's get
ooh.
It.
Ooh. Ooh. Hold on. I gotta find a beat.
Gotta find a beat?
What?
We don't have time for that. All right. Roses are red. Violets are yellow. I like other fellows.
Hey! There we go! Wow! Wow. Bars. Scarrow. Amazing. Vincent, please.
Okay. Yeah. Listen, that's what I'm here for, Lois. Okay, I do have to ask, because you did mention it. You said you took a nap between map 2 and 3. Was that just like rejuvenation? Like, explain what happened.
Bro, first day back at school, it was only a half day, so like just saying hello to the teachers, but it took a lot out of me. Same with the first two maps. I felt like they were just, the tensions were high. You know, I know some of the guys on the other team, good people. And, you know, I just had to let some nerves out. Just calm myself.
Good team, good people. So you had to ruin their day by destroying them. Understandable.
Oh, my. Oh, my. The player was left speechless. Regardless, so tell me more about, you know, the players on the opposing team. What's the history between you and the roster of 0-7 Aquila?
So about half of them, right? Let's see. Ooh, off the dome, Nodlin played with me and Frost Surge in the Hyperion Invitational, it was the Open Cup. Yeah, Open Cup, undefeated champions, and Schism, Rocko Neko also played for Permafrost for a little bit. And, you know, they went their ways. 0-7, new team, right? And it was a rivalry match, you know. Obviously, it's great to see him, even better to beat him. Frosters still undefeated.
Is that the way it's going to stay for this?
Oh, 100%. I think they're probably the best competition we'll get. Okay. And hey, you see how it's been going so far. I think we can keep it rolling.
Wow.
Yeah, well, that all sounds good. You're 2-0. And actually 6-0 if we're talking about that map differential, undefeated, not a single map lost. Now, we already know the story. You guys are taking this by storm. The Frost Surge taking the Hyperion Invitational by storm. But we got to know, do you have anyone you want to give a special shout out to before we close this broadcast?
Rook, he's just been keeping it strong, right? I've been playing for Permafrost for, what, year and a half now? He's been with me through ups, downs, whole shebang. My boy Ziggy Zoo, we go to high school together. He's the GOAT. Omni, best Lucio on the box. Swarmgig, cracked, mad, better than me. Cabodozer, perma benched.
Oh, okay. Well, that's, I'm sure Cabodozer is happy about that little shout out. But thank you so much, Scarrow. We appreciate you pulling up and congratulations on the victory.
Thank you.
All right, folks. So that's going to be it for us here at the Hyperion Cup 2, Week 2. We're going to send another broadcast on Sunday, so the action will continue later this weekend. But for now, thank you so much for joining us. I'm Los, joined by Vincent. Thank you for coming, and have a great night.
See ya.